So both India and Pakistan, when they came into being, obviously they could not have made their own constitution within a night. So they were now using the Government of India Act of 1935, the constitution that was made by the British government when India was the colony of the British government. So that constitution was known as the Government of India Act 1935. And both Pakistan and India were using that constitution. By being the dominions of UK meant that both of the countries would be using the law made by the British. And the British, although the British would not be directly interfering into the governments of India and Pakistan, but still the Queen or the King of Britain would be the head of state of both the countries. It meant that whoever would be the King or Queen of Britain, the Pakistani government and the Indian government would still be obedient to the British King or Queen, even after independence, until they make their own law. So, India was fortunate enough to make it within 3 to 4 years, and India came out of that dominion status that the British had given them. But it took Pakistan 9 years to come out of that dominion status. And meanwhile, for the 9 years, Pakistan kept on using the British law, the Government of India Act of 1935. Now, what were the problems of Government of India Act 1935 that we decided to have our own constitution? Number one, it was made at a time when the British were the rulers of India and India was the colony of Britain. So treating a colony is a different thing, and running your own country, an independent country, is a different thing. You could not have used the same law that the British, the masters, were using for their subordinates. Obviously, we needed a new law that would be for an independent country like Pakistan, so that everyone would be treated equally, not like the master and slave relationship that once the Indians had during the colonial rule of the British Empire. The question that here we see on screen is the 7 marks question, and it has come several times in the past papers as well. Why was there a delay in the making of first constitution of Pakistan? The major reason behind the delay in making the first constitution of Pakistan was the leadership crisis. What do we mean by leadership crisis? When Pakistan came into being, Pakistan had very sincere and very capable leaders like Jinnah and Liaquat Ali Khan. But unfortunately for Pakistan, Muhammad Ali Jinnah, the first Governor General of Pakistan, died in 1948. And then the first Prime Minister of Pakistan, Liaquat Ali Khan, and a close companion of Muhammad Ali Jinnah, he was assassinated in 1951. It meant that the country lost two of its very capable and very sincere leaders initially, soon after the independence. This would mean that if you won't have experienced leaders, you won't be able to make the law soon enough. And that is one of the reasons why it took so long for Pakistan to make the first constitution. I would add one more point over here, just in the leadership crisis, that is the experienced politicians. What do I mean by the experienced leaders? So you must have studied the section 2 of history, and in the section 2 of history you must have studied the timeline from 1937 till 39, which you would have studied as the Congress tyranny. In the Congress tyranny, you would have studied how the Congress ruled in 8 out of 11 provinces of India. So that's a big thing. Means the Congress party had experienced leaders who had the experience of ruling India even during the time of the British rule. They had been in the power in some of the provinces. They knew how to take up the ministries, how to manage the affairs of the provinces, and they also became the part of the central government as well during the time of the British colonial rule. But unfortunately, the leaders of Muslim League did not have such experience. Yes, they did win in the elections of 1945-46, but they did not take up as much power as the Congress had taken up. And this accounts for how the Congress, when India got independence from the British rule, the leaders of the Congress were upfront in tackling the problems faced by India after independence, and they managed it in a very good way, as compared to what Pakistan had while Jinnah was alive, while Liaquat Ali Khan was alive. We did tackle a lot of problems, but unfortunately, most of the problems remained, and still they are where they were. Secondly, we talk about the disagreements that the Pakistanis had on the drafts of the constitution. So when we talk about the drafts of the constitution, I would want to put emphasis on the work of Liaquat Ali Khan towards making the first constitution of Pakistan. I mean, when Liaquat Ali Khan was the prime minister, it's not like he did not do anything for the constitution of Pakistan. Yes, Liaquat Ali Khan did something. If you recall, Liaquat Ali Khan was the one who had announced the objectives resolution in the Assembly of Pakistan, which set out the basic structure that would become the part of Pakistan's constitution. It consisted of the rights of humans, the rights of minorities, the rights of different religious groups, the rights of different ethnic groups, etc., the freedom of speech, the freedom to propagate, the freedom to practice own religion, things like that. So it was a very important document, and it still is the part of Pakistan. It still is the part of the Pakistan's constitution. But during the time of Liaquat Ali Khan, he had presented a draft of the constitution. What do we mean by the draft of the constitution? Draft means a rough document that only showed what needed to be to become the part of the constitution, but it never was accepted to become the real constitution. So it remained as a draft. It wasn't a finished document. So what's the process of making the constitution? The process of making the constitution is that there must be some committee of politicians working together in setting out some rules and regulations that need to be the part of the constitution. They would write it in a document which we call the draft. The draft is then presented in the assembly in front of all the politicians, and the voting is done over there on the resolution that whether this draft should become the real constitution or not. If the majority of the members of the assembly vote in favor of the draft, it becomes the constitution of the country. And if the majority of the members of the assembly reject the draft, it does not become the constitution, it does not become the law. And imagine the close companion of Jinnah, the first prime minister of Pakistan, a very sincere and capable person like Liaquat Ali Khan, had presented the draft, the first ever draft in the assembly in 1950, but it was rejected by the assembly. And so it never became the law. It never became the constitution. Another such attempt was done by the second prime minister of Pakistan. Khwaja Nazimuddin was the second prime minister of Pakistan. And he was the second person to bring about another draft in the assembly for discussion, for acceptance to become the new, to become the first constitution. That was back in 1952. And again, this draft was rejected by the majority of the members of the assembly, and it also never became the part of the never became the constitution of Pakistan. So imagine, our politicians initially were working very hard, and we were just going simultaneously with India in terms of pace, that when India was able to make their first constitution within 4 years, Pakistan was also doing up the same thing. But the problem was, in India, the things got accepted, while in Pakistan, these drafts were getting rejected. And do you know what were the reasons behind the disagreements? These disagreements were because of the sharing of power between the East and the West. Bengal was the largest province of Pakistan after independence, in terms of population especially. And Bengali people wanted to have more seats in the assembly as compared to the West, all of the West Pakistan, but they were not being granted such rights, and so there were disagreements. Moreover, there were some disagreements and criticisms from the religious parties of Pakistan, who claimed that these drafts were not much religious, were not much Islamic. They believed that as Pakistan was made in the name of Islam, so there must be Islamic principles, more Islamic principles in the drafts in order to become the constitution of Pakistan. So this was another reason behind the disagreement. And the third reason behind the disagreement on the drafts was the status of the Bengali language. You know, when Muhammad Ali Jinnah, the first Governor General and the founder of Pakistan, was in government, he had announced that Pakistan would have only one national language, and that is Urdu. According to Jinnah, if we are to be seen as one nation, then we must have one national language. But the Bengali population, even during the time of Jinnah, some of the students protested against Jinnah as well, because they believed when Bengalis are more in terms of population, when they're in majority, their language should be given the preference. Their language should become the 56%, the language of the 56% should get the status of the national language rather than the language of only 2%. But their demands were also not fulfilled, and this also resulted in the disagreements on the draft. Then Pakistan was faced with some other issues, and these other issues distracted our prime ministers and governor generals from making the constitution of Pakistan. Such issues are not limited, but some of such issues are anti-Ahmadiyya riots, Bengali language movement, food shortages resulted in the delay of constitution. What were the anti-Ahmadiyya riots? During 1953, when Khwaja Nazimuddin was the prime minister and Malik Ghulam Muhammad was the governor general of the country, some communal violence started, especially between the two religious groups, the Ahmadis and the Jamaat Islami, who had started these riots. They had been asking for the removal of Ahmadis from the administration of the country. When these demands were not fulfilled, some bloodshed started, especially in Lahore, all over Punjab, but especially in Lahore. The Prime Minister wasn't able to control such riots, and this distracted the attention of Prime Minister from working more towards the constitution. Similarly, the Bengali language movement also was a hindrance in making the first constitution of Pakistan, because they were the major source of disagreement in the drafts, and the Bengali people were getting organized not only for their own language, but were also realizing that their status in Pakistan needs to be better. It should not be like that East Pakistan is treated like a colony of West Pakistan. They believed that their culture should be promoted just like the culture of any other province of West Pakistan. Moreover, during the time of Khwaja Nazimuddin, the country was faced with food shortages, and so ultimately this resulted in the delay in the constitution. When Khwaja Nazimuddin was dismissed, the government of bureaucrats started. Who are the bureaucrats? So bureaucrats were actually the civil servants, and here I would want to tell you about another story. That is, in Pakistan there came a time from 1953 onwards that is said to be the government of bureaucrats, especially by the people like Malik Ghulam Muhammad, Muhammad Ali Bogra, and Iskandar Mirza. Why are we calling them the bureaucrats? Because these people, before entering into the active politics of Pakistan, had been serving in the civil administration of Pakistan. But soon, these people assumed power, and these people were the ones who were leading the government of Pakistan and not the active politicians. This gives you a hint of something known as the power struggle. What do we mean by the power struggle? Power struggle is the term used especially in our politics throughout history, that we see examples of different institutions fighting for power. Who are the different institutions and the different entities that have been involved in the power struggle in Pakistan? So starting with, firstly, we talk about the politicians who believe themselves as the real stakeholders. There came a time when the politicians got weaker, and so the bureaucrats started to assume power. Although, if we study from the ideology of Jinnah, if we study the words of Jinnah, he did not want such kind of thing happening in Pakistan. He had stated out very clearly that different institutions should not interfere in each other's work. And similarly, we saw another such example from the judiciary of Pakistan in 1955 in something called constitutional crisis. If you don't remember that, don't worry, we'll do it again. Another such entity that we'll soon read about, study about in history, was Army of Pakistan when it imposed the first martial law in 1958. And another such entity that we can discuss about have been the religious groups which also want to take control. Now there can be so many others as well, but I have just outlined the few that since the beginning of Pakistan, these were some of the entities which were fighting for power, which were fighting to assume power, to assume the government. And this resulted in the delay in making the first constitution of Pakistan. Now, when there was power struggle, we saw the dismissals of prime ministers like Khwaja Nazimuddin, who served only for 2 years, and Muhammad Ali Bogra, who served only for 2 years. My point is, if a government is not allowed to work for 5 years, then how do you expect them to deliver properly? I mean, in democracy, we need to give time for the elected governments to work for the betterment, to make laws, to do the social and economic development for the people. But it is only possible if you provide them with ample time to work, which wasn't given in this case, and hence resulted in the delay in making the first constitution. So let us see what is the meaning of constitutional crisis and what was happening in Pakistan. So in Pakistan, we had a governor general, and this governor general had a name, Malik Ghulam Muhammad. And during that time, he had appointed a prime minister. And his name was Muhammad Ali Bogra. Now, in 1954, it happened that Malik Ghulam Muhammad, the governor general, had went to USA for some official visit, while Muhammad Ali Bogra, the prime minister, was still in Pakistan. And so in the National Assembly of Pakistan, Muhammad Ali Bogra brought forward a resolution. And what was this resolution? This resolution was, let's cut down some of the powers of the governor general. Now, when I said when Pakistan came into being, Pakistan was using the law made by the British government, that is the Government of India Act 1935. So you can understand, you can imagine that that law gave a lot of powers to the governor general, because the British viceroys who used to be here in India and rule in India, those people had the designation of governor general, and those people had, the British people had exclusive powers, executive powers to rule India. And such powers were now being held by the Governor General Malik Ghulam Muhammad as well. But it wasn't necessary. this isn't a colony, this isn't a British rule. We're living in an independent country, and Muhammad Ali Bogra wanted the support of the people of the National Assembly to support this resolution that now it's time to cut down the powers of the Governor General, because we're living in a country where we're all independent, and so one person should not have so much authority over everything. Fortunately for Muhammad Ali Bogra, this resolution brought in the assembly got accepted. And when it got accepted, it meant that soon the power of the Governor Generals would end. But then Malik Ghulam Muhammad returned back to Pakistan. So when Malik Ghulam Muhammad came back from USA to Pakistan, he waited for Muhammad Ali Bogra to go on official visit to USA and UK. You know what happened when Muhammad Ali Bogra went to USA and UK? During that time, Malik Ghulam Muhammad, the Governor General, dismissed the entire assembly of Pakistan. Muhammad Ali Bogra was called back to Pakistan, and Malik Ghulam Muhammad told him that you do not have your assembly anymore. I am the one with power, and you'll have to obey me. I will appoint your team, and you'll have to work with that team only. That's your powers, and this is how I would rule the country. Now, this type of struggle is known as the power struggle, and this resulted in something called the constitutional crisis, because you can see a conflict between two of the most important designations in Pakistan, the Governor General versus the Prime Minister. But the story doesn't end over here. It gets more worse. How? When this National Assembly was dismissed, in this National Assembly, there was a designation of a person known as the Speaker of National Assembly. A speaker is a designation which conducts the assembly. This person allows people to talk. This person allows people to proceed with the happenings of the assembly. So this is what a speaker does. So when entire assembly was dismissed, the speaker was also dismissed. This speaker was Maulvi Tamizuddin. Maulvi Tamizuddin was the speaker of this dismissed assembly. What Maulvi Tamizuddin did, he took this case to the Supreme Court, to the High Court of Pakistan. So this decision of Malik Ghulam Muhammad of dismissing the entire assembly was challenged in the High Court of Pakistan. It was the Sindh High Court, and the Sindh High Court gave the decision in favor of Maulvi Tamizuddin, that Maulvi Tamizuddin is right and Malik Ghulam Muhammad is wrong. What would Malik Ghulam Muhammad do now? Malik Ghulam Muhammad challenged the decision of High Court into a supreme authority, that is the Supreme Court of Pakistan. Hold on, I'm just erasing some of the part over here, okay, to make space. So what Malik Ghulam Muhammad did, he challenged this decision into the Supreme Court of Pakistan, and the Supreme Court of Pakistan gave the decision in favor of Malik Ghulam Muhammad. What you can observe over here, you can observe how the different institutions of the country are fighting against each other. I mean, initially you saw the Prime Minister versus the Governor General, and then you saw the Speaker of the Assembly against the Governor General. Then you saw High Court against the Supreme Court. It means that why we call this constitutional crisis? Because the law could not be interpreted in a single accurate way. Everybody was trying to interpret law themselves in their own way. High Court had its own way. Supreme Court had its own way. And if I tell you the final statement of the judge of Supreme Court, you would be astonished to know what he meant. You know what the judge of the Supreme Court said? The judge of the Supreme Court said that Malik Ghulam Muhammad is right according to the doctrine of necessity. what is meant by the doctrine of necessity? By the doctrine of necessity, it is meant that if there is a need, then the governor can do whatever he wants to do. Now, this was a very loose statement by the judge of Supreme Court, because we'll see in the future the consequences, the adverse consequences it had later in the politics of Pakistan. This example, unfortunately, was used several times in Pakistan to dismiss the government on the doctrine of necessity. So on this slide, you can see all the reasons which delayed the constitution making process in Pakistan from 1947 till 1956.